A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, bismillah ar-rahman ar-rahim. I'd like to welcome you to a new episode of The Beacon of Truth. Today I'd like to welcome my studio audience, my panel of esteemed guests, and most of all, my beloved viewers at home. Today we have with us Qasid Moin Sab, Ayaz Mahmood Khan Sab, and Abdul Qudus Sab. In previous programs, we've talked about the coming of a promised individual. We've discussed how this individual was given signs and prophecies regarding his advent. We discussed how all the major religions talked about this coming of this person who would come in the latter days. Now the question that obviously arises here is that the Ahmadiyya Jama'at, founded by Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani alayhi salatu wasalam, the promised Messiah and Mahdi, claims that this promised Messiah was in fact Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. So the question that obviously arises here is that how can we claim, how do we attribute those signs and those prophecies to the person of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani alayhi salatu wasalam? Now as Muslims, the two fundamental and foundational stones upon which we build our building of belief on is the Quran and the Hadith. So therefore it is imperative that we look to these two stones to understand where those signs come from, how they were fulfilled, and how in fact we can attribute them and use them to prove the truthfulness of the claim of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani alayhi salatu wasalam as the promised Messiah and Mahdi. So Qasid Sab, obviously the first place that we'll look to is the Holy Quran as Muslims. So where are these signs in the Holy Quran, and where are they and how were they fulfilled?
Jazakallah Mansoor. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Now, it's very essential that we do understand, actually, in actual fact, that what were the signs of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, in the Quran? Because this is a very fundamental question which our non-Ahmadi brethren and sisters always ask us. Now, first and foremost, I've got a few verses from the Holy Quran. There are loads and loads of verses which can be brought forth, but the time will not permit me. But I've selected a few verses. The first and foremost verse I have chosen is from Surah Sajda, verse 6, in which Allah the Almighty says, "A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim, yudabbiru al-amra minas samai ilal ardi. يدبر الأمر من السماء إلى الأرض ثم يعرج إليه في يوم كان مقداره ألف سنة مما تعدون." I'll read the translation. "He will plan the divine ordinance from the heaven unto the earth. Then shall it go up to him in a day, the duration of which is 1,000 years, according to what you reckon." Now in this verse, Allah the Almighty has said to mankind that he will plan the divine ordinance. What is the divine ordinance? That's the question. The divine ordinance is in fact Islam. It's very clear to understand the divine ordinance which Allah the Almighty at that time when he was sending the Quran down was Islam. The name of that religion, that belief, was Islam. So once he's sent down Islam, it shall go up to him in a day. One day it shall go up to him, it shall rise up to him. This is what Allah the Almighty is saying in the Holy Quran. It shall rise up to him one day, and it will stay up there for a day according to what God says, and then God says, according to what you believe, as 1,000 years. So 1,000 years, that belief will be up in the sky. First, and the first thing that comes into mind, I'm sure some of you will be thinking, is that hadith of Hazrat Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in which he says that لو كان الإيمان معلقا بالثريا لنا له رجل من هؤلاء, that when the faith rises up to the Pleiades, which is a star in up in space, one man from Islam shall bring that faith back down, because that faith has risen up. He was referring to this verse of the Holy Quran, because in this verse it says that faith will have risen up. Now, when will those 1,000 years appear? That's the question. Now, in another hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we find that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, I'll say the Arabic and then translate it, "خير القرون قرني," the best of centuries is my century. "ثم الذين يلونهم," then the ones who meet them, the ones after that century, and the one after that. Hence, basically it will be 3 centuries. Those will be 300 years. So 1,300 years after the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this will come. Why? Because 300 years have gone. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this will be the prime of Islam. What will happen after that? It's very obvious. It's rhetorical. You don't have to say what's going to happen after that. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said it himself. There will be 3 centuries in which Islam will be in its prime. Then after that, it will face a downfall, which will be these 1,000 years, which are said in the Holy Quran. 1,300 years after, what do we see? we see Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian alayhi salatu wasalam claiming that he is the Mahdi prophesied by Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wasalam. It's a very clear verse of the Holy Quran. I don't think there needs to be any more explanation. Now, other few verses which I have selected are from Surah Takweer, in which many prophecies have been made in such small verses. Now, at apparent, they're very small verses, but they have such like huge meaning within themselves. I'll present a few before you. The first verse of this surah is, in fact, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ, that when the sun is wrapped up. Now, what comes to mind when we hear of this? When the sun connotes the faith instilled in the hearts of men, instilled into the hearts of believers, because the sun is a bright thing. Brightness connotes faith, connotes a positive thing. So when faith is completely evaporated from the face of the earth, this the sign of Qiyamah will come, because regarding this surah, Ahadith is of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that if you wish to observe the signs of Qiyamah, what will Qiyamah be in the Holy Quran? Hazur said, look at one of the surahs, which he said was look at Surah Takweer. So in this verse, he says that when the sun is completely wrapped up. Another meaning of this can be the eclipse, which was prophesied by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are many verses, I think, because the time is quite short. I'll just select a few more. وَإِذَا الصُّحُفُ نُشِرَتْ, when books are spread abroad. Now just put yourself in that time of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the Quran was written on leaves. There were no books. It was so hard to imagine for even those companions, I'm sure, that when books will be spread abroad, sitting right now, it's very easy to understand that, you know, what's the amazing thing in this. But at that time, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was saying that something big will happen when the books are spread abroad. Another sign is وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ, that when the beasts are gathered together, it's very simple to understand. Zoos, how at that time beasts were, you know, they were walking, lurking the earth just like man was. But the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that beasts will be gathered together. They are gathered in the homes of people, like dogs, cats. But we see that in zoos, lions, bears, giraffes, all sorts of animals are joined, combined together into one cage or one fixed location. Now, in another place of the Holy Quran, in Surah An-Naml, I'll just like to mention one more verse. The Quran relates to the plague which was to appear in the sign of the Holy of the promised Messiah, salatu wasalam. Now, how can that be possible? I'll read the verse. The Holy Quran says, وَإِذَا وَقَعَ الْقَوْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ أَخْرَجْنَا لَهُمْ دَابَّةً مِنَ الْأَرْضِ, that when the sentence is passed against them, in Arabic, the waqa al-qawlu alayhim means that when the task of spreading the message has been fulfilled to them, when the message has been conveyed to them, we shall bring forth from the earth. We shall bring forth for them an insect. Now, you'll be asking me, how does a plague come from insect? Well, the Promised Messiah salatu wasalam has mentioned a very interesting fact in Nuzul al-Masih, a book of the Promised Messiah. He said that the plague, in actual fact, it has recently been discovered by, at that time, the Promised Messiah salatu wasalam said that at that time, it has been recently discovered that the plague starts off from a very small insect. And that insect, in fact, looks, it is like two nukta, or two dots, what we call in English. And the two dots, he said, those two dots are the microscopic figure. I can't draw it for you, but that's what it shows. That's what the insect looked like. Now, the Promised Messiah, salatu wasalam, mentioned it in a very small sentence, but it's such an interesting fact. He said that two circles bore witness for me in the sky, and two dots bore witness for me in the ground as well. The two circles in the sky were the sun and the moon, the eclipse, and the two dots were this insect. There are many prophecies in the Quran which I would have liked to mention, but I think the time wouldn't permit me.
Important to realize here that we've talked about these different signs, the different prophecies mentioned in the Quran, Surah Takweer and Surah An-Naml, just to name a very, very small number. And the important thing to remember is that, for example, say in Surah Taqweer, when we talked about there's 13 prophecies in Surah Taqweer regarding the latter days. These 13 prophecies were regarding the latter days, and also it was said by the Holy Prophet Muhammad that the promised Messiah would come in the latter days. Therefore, the promised Messiah, these signs can only be done, only prove the truthfulness of the claim of the promised Messiah when we understand that they were both to come in the latter days. We see the signs being completed now, being fulfilled. We see the new modes of transport, we see women's rights, we see zoos, we see all of these things coming together now. So it's imperative that for the purpose of the truthfulness of the Quran, of Allah, for the Prophet Muhammad's truthfulness, it is imperative that we understand that these beautiful signs of the Quran were fulfilled in this day and age. And similarly, it was imperative, because of the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, for a promised Messiah to also come in this day and age. Hence, not just proving the truthfulness of the claim of the promised Messiah, but also of God, Allah, and the Holy Quran.
So I'd just like to mention one thing, that if our viewers at home would like to see these writings on the Promised Messiah themselves, then there is a page in Shahadatul Quran. They can read Shahadatul Quran. It's a small booklet of 100 pages. You can read that. And the Promised Messiah has mentioned in great detail the signs of the Promised Messiah, not only in the Quran, but the Ahadith as well. So that would be quite cool.
The second place that we need to look at, after we've looked at the Holy Quran, is obviously, as was stated earlier in the beginning, is Hadith. Are the sayings of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we've understood and established the fact that these signs do exist very, very clearly in the Holy Quran. But now let's take a brief glance at those signs that came in the Hadith. Abu Ghulam, could you explain some of these signs? Could you explain to the audience how these signs came about and how in fact they were fulfilled and how they actually proved to be a source of truth for the claim of the Promised Messiah sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
So again, like Qasoof has mentioned, that there are many signs that were fulfilled in favor of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Sahib alayhi salatu wasalam. And I shall only present three before you. You should remember that the Ahadith mentioned the time period when the Messiah will come, what works he will be carrying out, and also it's related to how he may even look like, how he will look like, not may, how he will look like. But I shall only present three before you because of constraint of time. The first one I would like to mention is with regards to what the Messiah will do. The Holy Prophet ﷺ states, فَيَكْسُرُ السَّلِيبَ وَيَقْتُلُ الْخِنْزِيرِ. This is from Bukhari Kitab al-Anbiya. Meaning that the Messiah, or Ibn Maryam, will basically break the cross and kill the swine. Immediately when we put these two words together, the cross and swine, one thinks about one only that religion, Christianity. So how can we say Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salatu wasalam broke the cross and killed the swine? Or was it a literal physical breaking or a physical killing? Of course not. The fact of the matter is, in the 19th century in British India, Christianity was spreading like fire. We see that those scholars of Islam, for example, Imamuddin, Abdullah Atim, who were renowned scholars of Islam, of Muslims, they started converting to Christianity. Why was this? These Christian missionaries, they said that, hold on, you claim that Jesus Christ is still alive in the heavens, whereas your prophet, who you claim to be the best of prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's passed away and is buried in the earth. Clearly, that means that Jesus Christ has is more special, and his status is much grander than the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, God forbid. And they said, this is the reason why Jesus Christ is divine, is the Lord. So when hearing these arguments in British India, many people, many Muslims, which amount to millions, started converting to Christianity. An American evangelist in 1888, the governor of Punjab, his name Mr. Atkinson, he claims that that the native Indians, the native Indian meaning the subcontinent people, they have accepted Christianity and the number of souls are millions. So this clearly shows that a Messiah, a prophet was needed so that Islam could come back to its previous grandeur. Therefore, God Almighty commissioned his Messiah in the form of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salatu wasalam, who came and claimed to be the Messiah. In 1889, he set up a whole community to break the cross and kill the swine. Breaking and killing, not physically, but through arguments, he basically annihilated the illogical arguments and thoughts and faith of Christianity, like for example Trinity, the concept of atonement, the concept of the divinity of Christ. He absolutely abolished this thing. And we find that in 1893, a debate happened between Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam and the padres of the time, the vicars of the time. And Hazur was outstanding, and he absolutely destroyed their illogical views.
In absolutely every sense.
So this is how he done, يَكْسُرُ السِّلِيبَ وَيَقْتُلُ الْخِنْزِيرُ. The second hadith that I would like to mention is that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has prophesied an institution of mujaddideen, meaning reformers. It is related in Abu Dawud, Kitab al-Fitan, that إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَبْعَثُ عَلَى رَأْسِ كُلَّ مِئَةِ سَنَةٍ مَنْ يُجَدِّدُ لَهَا دِينَهَا. That is to say, that surely in my ummah, God Almighty will commission mujaddideens at the head, at the turn of every century. We see that the Muslim Ummah from the very first century after the demise of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, these mujaddideen came and the Muslim Ummah accepted them. For example, the first mujaddid, Hazrat Umar bin Abdul Aziz, then Imam Shafi, then later on Abdul Qadir Sahib Jilani, many, 13 mujaddideens were accepted and they are recorded in many books. But we see in the 14th century, suddenly, God forbid, this prophecy was not fulfilled. How can this be? For 1300 years, a prophecy is being fulfilled at the head of every century. But then God Almighty suddenly says, no, hold on. We don't need any more mujaddideens. Of course this is not the case. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam claimed to be the mujaddid of the time in 1885, and many people accepted him. Majority of the Muslim Ummah accepted him. Yes, in 1891, when he claimed to be the Messiah and Mahdi, these people rejected his claim. But then these non-Ahmadi brothers of ours, they say that, hold on, the 14th century has been extended now. So a mujaddid can come still. Yes. And they say we are still within that 14th century. How absurd is this view?
Exactly. I mean, how absurd is it to actually say, well, okay, for 1300 years, a mujaddid has been coming, a reformer has been coming, according to divine prophecy by God Almighty, and fulfilling the truthfulness of the Holy Prophet and the Quran and God. But after the 13th mujaddid is gone, when the question comes down to the 14th, when it comes time to actually accept the fact that a promised Messiah and a reformer has come, then, well, no, the 14th century has actually been extended now. The 14th century doesn't actually mean 100 years. In fact, it's a figurative amount of speech. It means anything from 100 years and above. It seems that our non-Ahmadi brothers almost seem to be changing.
They accepted him before.
Yes.
Right? And then rejected him. Mm. This is just ridiculous, in my opinion. Now, the last of these, because of the short time, I would like to mention is a grand prophecy made by Hazur sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It's so unique in every way. Hazur says, the hadith is, Inna la mahdiyana ayatain. That surely for our Mahdi, for our divine reformer, there are two signs. Lam takuna mundhu khalqis samawati wal ard. That these signs have never, ever taken place since the creation of the heavens and the earth. What are these two signs? Yan kasiful qamaru li awwala laylatin min Ramadan. That the lunar eclipse will happen on the first day of the night of Ramadan. What is the second sign that the Holy Prophet ﷺ described? تَنْكَسِفُ الشَّمْسُ فِي النِّسْفِ مِنْهُ. That the solar eclipse will also happen in the same month of Ramadan on the second day. This is from Darul Qutni, by the way.
But a question that obviously arises, I'm speaking on behalf of absolutely everyone here, that we see clearly in the hadith that it says of the first night and in the middle of Ramadan as the two specific times where these events will happen. Yet we see that the actual solar and lunar eclipses that happened were on the 13th and the 28th of that month. Absolutely. So I'm speaking on behalf of everyone here that there seems to be
a very valid point. It's a very valid point.
Here.
Yeah, absolutely. As you've mentioned, that the sign was fulfilled in 1894. On the 13th of Ramadan, the lunar eclipse happened, and on the 28th of Ramadan, the solar eclipse happened. So the words of the hadith were the awwala laylatin, that the first night. The fact of the matter is, Mansoor, that since the creations of heaven and earth, it's the nature speaks for itself that these eclipses happen on the 13th, 14th, or 15th of every lunar month. So we cannot say that God Almighty will suddenly change his system and say that the first day of Ramadan. it had to happen either on the 13th, 14th, or 15th, and the Hadith said the first night, and it happened on the 13th of Ramadan. Similarly, the solar eclipse can only happen on the 27th, 28th, and 29th of a lunar month. And we see again, it happened on the 28th of the Ramadan. So this is actually, again, you see that how grand this prophecy was. That exactly at that time, 1400 years ago, when no one knew any science about astronomy in a sense, it wasn't very, as they call it, no one was an expert in astronomy
back
then.
It was a vast topic, right? Science
exactly.
And astronomy is a vast
exactly.
topic.
Exactly.
And so for somebody, for them to actually give a prophecy and for them to actually know, well, not them know, for Allah Ta'ala to give that divine knowledge to the Holy Prophet to be able to make this prophecy, saying, well, in fact, it will happen on the first night. And those people that had the knowledge, who actually know anything about astronomical cycles, will know that it is impossible. It's impossible for that eclipse to happen on the first night. Find any example in history, at any point in the world, where it's happened on the first of the lunar calendar. Never. It's never happened. So why would God change it, as Qudus Sahib said? Now many people would say, well, no, God could do it if he wanted to. Well, there was no need, for the prophecy clearly said that it would happen on the first. And there's only three possible days when it could have happened. And it did happen on the first. Not on the second or the third, it did happen on the first. So this prophecy was beautifully fulfilled.
Yeah, Mansoor, this prophecy, like I said before, in 1894 was fulfilled in the East. And in 1895, the same lunar and solar eclipse in the month of Ramadan, in the same month of Ramadan, took place in the West, and people saw it.
Not just once, so it happened twice.
Basically, God Almighty published this grand prophecy in the skies for everyone to see. And everyone was held accountable for, that you are witness to my Messiah. That Messiah that was prophesied 1400 years ago by the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has come now. So you are witness. Every individual was witness to that fact.
It was beamed up onto the starry absolutely. Night sky for absolutely everyone to bear witness to the truthfulness of God, the Holy Prophet, the hadiths that were made, and the truthfulness of the claim of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam. Okay, well, thank you, brilliant. One of the questions that obviously arises again, we've talked about the Quran and the hadiths, and we've established categorically the fact that the signs are present in the Quran and in the hadiths. Now, any Muslim will say that we take our belief from the Quran and Hadith. And if we are able, therefore, to establish these signs from the Quran and Hadith, there is absolutely there's no leeway left to say, well, no, I don't really believe that these signs existed. These signs existed, and they happened, fulfilled in exactly the way they needed to happen. And they happened exactly at the time that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and they happened at exactly the right time to prove categorically the truth of the claim of the promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Qadiani alayhi salatu wasalam. Now I'd like to turn to the audience. Do we have any questions about, we've talked quite a lot about the Quran and Hadith and the signs that have come up so far. So I'm pretty sure that you would have questions by now. Yes sir, please.
Brother mentioned the hadith on the eclipses. I just wanted to ask, the hadith you mentioned was from Darul Qutri. Is any other book of ahadith mentioned this particular prophecy?
Good, sir.
I'm not aware of any other book which has prophesied this. But with regards to this book, I'd like to make a point here that people claim that this hadith is very weak. The fact of the matter is that we see that this prophecy is mentioned in the Holy Quran. So we don't need any other hadith, book of hadith, to actually support our argument. In Surah Qiyamah, we find that God Almighty says that the moon will be eclipsed and the sun will also be joined with it. So this prophecy is clearly stated in Surah Qiyamah. Now the second thing is that when people say that this book, this whole prophecy is weak and that it's unauthentic, we should remember that these very Maulvis at the time of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, they were awaiting this sign. When Hazur Messiah claimed in 1891 to be the Messiah in Mahdi, these people were saying, hold on, where is that grand prophecy that was made for the Holy the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam made? Then Hazur alayhi salatu wasalam, in Nur al-Haq, it's written in part two, that these people were anticipating it with great anticipation.
Yes.
They're waiting with great anticipation. And when it did happen, these very people said, hold on, people are going to be led astray now. So, I mean, again, it's just people are alleging for no reason. When it was done, when it was not completed, they started alleging the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, and opposing it. And when it was completed, they said, hold on, people are going to go are going to be led astray. Yeah, so this is a absolutely a pointless argument that they are giving.
Jazakallah. I mean, another important point that we should always remember is the fact that when we see hadith, many people, because it will suit them, Maulvis, when it will suit them, they'll say, okay, well, we agree with this hadith, but this hadith, you know, well, it's zaif, it's not authentic, it's not strong enough for us to believe in it. An important point that we should all remember, and a point that Hazrat Masih alayhi salam also picked up on, is the fact that when a hadith is, say the hadith is zaif, for example, this Dar al-Qutni hadith, let's take this for example, regarding the eclipses. This hadith is made, this prophecy is made regarding an eclipse that will happen. Now we see, in the time of the Promised Messiah, this event did happen. So regardless of what the sanad was, what the chain of relation was, how weak you see this hadith, how strong you see this hadith was proved by God Almighty by two signs that no man with his physical hand could affect. This was a sign that happened in the skies for everyone to do with a divine power behind it. So regardless of whether this hadith was zaif or not, this event happened as was prophesied. So who then can say that this hadith is zaif when it was proved by the hand of God Almighty Himself? Okay, please. Yes, sir.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
My question is the phenomena of interpreting the hadith of Sayyidina Hazrat Aqdas Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding the particular subject we are talking about. The phenomena which has been presented by Jama'at, it has been widely opposed by the non-Ahmadi scholars, even though they have their own differences among themselves. And one of the argument they have given about it, that because Hazur sallallahu alaihi wasallam has used these particular words in his ahadith, so we have to stick to the literal meanings of those ahadith. And one of the example which just Qudus Sahib was mentioning about the hadith, Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam breaking the cross and killing the swine. It was only yesterday, one of the UK-based Islamic channel, one Maulvi Sahib was saying that it will happen, it will literally happen, and Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will break the cross, and he would be empowered by God Almighty, and he will kill the swine. So why we don't accept this ideology?
Okay, Jazakallah. What we're going to do is, well, briefly, something that we should always remember. I mean, Maulvis will say, okay, right, as I said before, it's always about what we want to take literally and what we don't want to take literally. And when it turns around, we switch it around whenever we feel like it. That's how a lot of people, unfortunately, Maulvis, would react like that. I mean, for example, just quickly, we'll go back to Ghassas Sahib afterwards. We'll come back to this in a second, but I'm going to ask Ayaz Sahib a question first. But just briefly on this, for us to imagine that a Messiah will come. And you know, we see nowadays that Christian people will walk around, you know, with those very, very small golden crosses on their chest. We see in the churches those huge iron and often wooden crosses that are inside there. Do we really imagine that a promised Messiah? I mean, we just think about in London, for example. Forget the UK, forget Europe, forget the world. Let's just take London, the one city. Imagine how many crosses there are in London, including that ones on a chain, ones in churches, ones on church steeples. Imagine how many crosses there are. Imagine how long it would take. For example, say yourself, if you were to go out now and start breaking crosses, you would come across one small small golden one. How long would it take you to break just that one cross? Would we really diminish the muqam, the level of the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, to come and physically be breaking these crosses in half? Is that really the need of the Muslim Ummah right now for somebody to come along and break these crosses? Is it really the need of the Muslim Ummah for a promised Messiah to come and take a knife and run around after pigs and beasts cutting their necks? Obviously this is not something that we need. This is not something that the Muslim Ummah needs. So in fact, if we don't take this literally, it makes the whole concept of the promised Messiah something which, to be honest, none of us need to respect, if we take this in that sense. Now cleverly, along with this, we've talked about how a physical and a literal interpretation is taken of a certain hadith. I also, one of the questions that comes in the hadith regarding the promised Messiah, والسلام, coming back along with what Qudus Sahib was talking about, is the mention of, yes, a Masih, but it also talks about a Masih al-Dajjal. Now, we touched on this briefly before about the Dajjal in previous programs, but what is this Masih al-Dajjal? Could you elaborate on this slightly?
Absolutely. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. The Dajjal is a grand prophecy of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If it is interpreted symbolically, as all religious prophecies and scriptures should be interpreted. When we take on the role of literalists, we lose the magnificence of that prophecy, just as we lose the magnificence of Yaksiru Salibu Yaqtulul Khinzir. It turns into a religion, turns into a jest. So too with the Dajjal, the problem is that many people have taken this literally, but it's not to be taken literally. Let me just explain. If we analyze linguistically what the meaning of Dajjal is, there are different meanings in different dictionaries. One of the meanings of Dajjal is kadhabun, a grand liar, a great liar, somebody who lies often. Then another meaning is somebody who covers up, because when you lie, you cover up the truth, right? Then another meaning of Dajjal is somebody or something that travels far and wide throughout the earth, and he does not leave a single territory which he has not traveled. Then another meaning is affluence, wealth, somebody who is very wealthy. This is also a meaning. Then another thing which is mentioned in the dictionaries is with regards to Dajjal is that allati tughatta al-arda bikathrati ahliha, that the Dajjal refers to a group of people who, due to their enormous multitude in number, in sheer number, they cover the earth. Tughatta al-arda. So these are five different definitions of the word Dajjal, and if anybody wishes to reference, this is mentioned in Lisanul Arab, which is a very authentic and classical dictionary of the Arabic language.
Not even something which is just an Ahmadi text. This is something which is worldwide known to absolutely everyone that knows even the smallest amount of Arabic or anything. When they refer to something, when they look in the dictionaries, we have
Lisanul Arab, which is a very famous classical dictionary.
And again, it's something important to notice the last point that you mentioned about it's being a group of people over the world, that because of the enormity of the group of people, it in fact covers the world.
Yeah.
This again beautifully talks about and elaborates on the fact that it's the Dajjal is not one person, as we discussed in previous programs. The Dajjal is a group of people regarding the way in which they do things, if I'm right.
Exactly. So I will allude to this further on as well, but basically the promised Messiah has mentioned this in his books, that they are a group of people or a number of people who fulfill this prophecy, as you have mentioned, and this is supported from not even religious texts, but a text of lexicon. Then when we look at the signs of the Dajjal, it is mentioned there, these signs are mentioned in different books, but in Mishkat, Kitabul Fitan, different ahadiths are mentioned. And one of the things which are mentioned is that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said that no prophet has come who has not warned his people of the fitna or the disorder of the Dajjal. And so I also warn you as well, because this is a great fitna, a great disorder which will overtake the earth. Then it is mentioned that the Dajjal will have one eye. His right eye will be blind, but his left eye will be very sharp, so sharp that it shall reach the depths of the earth. Then another thing which is mentioned about the Dajjal is that it would make a dead person alive again.
Yes, after killing.
After killing him. Then it is mentioned that the Dajjal, it would cause the clouds to rain down. Then it is mentioned that the Dajjal would travel the earth and tell the earth to grow its vegetation. So these are all things that the promised Messiah al-Islam has mentioned something very beautiful. He said that if we take this literally, that the Dajjal would kill a man and then make him alive and cause the clouds to rain and grow vegetation, these are divine attributes. So basically what we're doing, if we take it literally, is that we're attributing godly attributes to the Antichrist.
We're literally calling the Antichrist God.
In essence,
if we take the literal meaning of this hadith, we're calling the Antichrist, which was to come and try to attack Islam, we're literally calling that thing God. So this is the problem when we're always taking a literal meaning to a hadith. This is in fact what we're actually doing.
Then another meaning which also proves that this can't be literal is that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that at the forehead of the Dajjal it would be written kafire, kafara, disbeliever. And the Holy Prophet then went on to say that these are the words of the Holy Prophet, I'm not attributing them by myself. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that a believer would be able to read those words even if he is unlettered, Even if he does not know ABCs, he would be able to read that kafara on the forehead of the Dajjal. Now you tell me, if somebody doesn't know how to read, how can he read that on the forehead of the Dajjal? What is meant is that a believer who has a spiritual inner self, he would be able to recognize that the actions of the Dajjal would be in complete contradiction with the Holy Quran and with the injunctions of Allah the Almighty. So all of these signs, then I mentioned three signs as well, that the Dajjal would cause rain to come down and grow vegetation. The promised Messiah alayhi salam has mentioned that this refers to the scientific and technological discoveries of that nation who would be the Dajjal in the latter days, and their power, their dominion, as if they could kill a man and make him alive. And we see that different powers of the world, they are so powerful that it is as if they control the citizens of their land, and they don't do it for good purposes without naming any names.
We'll all be aware of the fact that when we go into a hospital, we see a person that has died on his heart monitor. The heart monitor is a dead line. There's that famous D noise. Well, we know this person's completely dead. Yet through scientific research, through scientific developments, the doctors are able to bring that person back to life. That person is medically proclaimed dead for however long amount of time. Yet scientific knowledge and scientific research is able to bring that person back to life. That person is clinically dead. Yet that person is brought back using the science of medicine. So this is surely, he's literally resuscitated. This surely again is something which completely is a beautiful fulfillment of this.
Yes, and then Mansur, it is also written in the Ahadith that the thing upon which, the donkey upon which the Dajjal would travel the earth, this is an outstanding thing too. It turns into a fairy tale if we take it physically.
This is something if literally we can recite this story to our children when we put
and they would be very impressed with that story. Yes, I assure definitely. You. So what is written about that? The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that he would be a huge donkey who would walk over the land and over the sea, and the water of the sea would only come up to his knees, and he would have fire in his belly, and he would call all of the people before departing that, now I am about to leave, anybody who wishes to enter shall enter my belly, and we will go on this journey. So the fire and the people are in that belly, but the people don't get harmed from that fire. Then the Dajjal's distance between his two ears would be about 70 cubits of measure. So all of these things, if we take it literally, what is left of religion? What this refers to, if we were to ask a child, what is this donkey referring to? I guarantee you that they would tell you that, mom and dad, this refers to the airplane. This speaks of ships. This speaks of modern forms of transport.
And yet the ulama, the greatest knowledgeable people, supposedly greatest knowledgeable people of the Muslim ummah, the best ummah of all time, cannot figure out that this is actually pointing towards modes of transport, as again Ghassid had pointed towards in the prophecy of the Holy Quran. We have absolutely all of these proofs pointing towards one specific thing. Yet the ulama, the greatest knowledgeable people of the greatest ummah, supposedly, are not able to understand this, are not able to give forward and present the look. This is the truthfulness of the claim. On one side they're saying, no, listen, we'll wait for this huge donkey with aeroplane ears, whose one foot is in the east and one foot is in the west. We'll wait for that, and that will prove how we are the best ummah, and how the prophecies of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the truthfulness of God and the existence of God are proved through this. But we won't. We will refuse to accept the fact that when a prophecy is beautifully and so obviously fulfilled that even children of 4 and 5 can understand it, we won't take that meaning, and we will refuse to accept that, because for some reason that seems to go against our belief.
And you know, Mansur, the promised Messiah alayhi salam in Haqiqatul Wahi, he has mentioned that if we were to accept that the Dajjal was anything other than this nation, which is at that time was Christianity, but it could be many other things as well, because the promised Messiah alayhi salam has also mentioned that the Dajjal is also philosophers who are godless. They don't believe in God. And the promised Messiah has even said that there are 100 different aspects of the Dajjal, different branches of the Dajjal. So if we were to accept that it was something other than Christianity or the faith of Christianity, the false ideologies of Christianity, the promised Messiah alayhi salam states in Haqiqatul Way that this would substantiate a contradiction in the Ahadith. Because in the same very Ahadith which allude to the coming of the Dajjal, they also say that the Christian church would be very dominant at that time.
Definitely.
So until we accept both of these things to be the same thing, we would have two different powers which would be working against each other. So this is why it alludes to. And then the promised Messiah alayhi salam also says that in Surah Al-Kahf, it is mentioned that the fitna of the Dajjal has been alluded to. And the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam has mentioned that in the latter days, if you wish to protect yourself from the Dajjal, the way you can protect yourself from the Dajjal is by reciting the first 10 surahs, the first 10 verses of Surah Al-Kahf. Yes. And what is written in Surah Al-Kahf? وَيُنذِرَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا اتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ وَلَدًا. That Allah warns those people who have said that Allah has taken on a son. And then Allah goes on in the next verse to say that كَبُرَتْ كَلِمَةً تَخْرُجُ مِنْ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ. That it is very bad, these words which these people attribute to God the Almighty. So these are one thing. And then let's say in the Ahadith it is also mentioned, we're talking about literalism, right? It is mentioned in the Ahadith that the Dajjal was circumambulating the Kaaba. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam alluded to this. Then it said that the Messiah was also circumambulating around the Kaaba. The promised Messiah alayhi salam says in Izala Oham that if we were to take this literally, then we would have to accept that the Dajjal was Muslim. Because only a Muslim would circumambulate the Kaaba, right?
So not only is the Dajjal God, he's also at the same time the Muslim.
Then it is also,
and also at the same time the
then
Prophet
it is
himself.
Also mentioned that in the Ahadith that the Dajjal would not be able to enter Mecca or Medina. So how is it possible for him to be circumambulating the Kaaba? The promised Messiah has done a very beautiful explanation of this. He says that just as a thief goes around at night to cause people harm, so too does a watchman go around at night in pursuit of that thief to put him down. And that was the purpose of the Messiah of the latter days, that he would come and fight against the false ideologies of that Dajjal who would cause havoc throughout the earth.
Okay, and well this is that. Again a topic which is absolutely vast. If all of us sat together and started discussing this, we would easily run over 3 or 4 programs, if not a lot more. So what we'll do is we'll actually come back to this topic, but I want to come to the audience again. Obviously, we've talked about a lot of things which can obviously bring a lot of questions up. So I want to hear what you have to say. Yes, please.
As-salamu alaykum. It's quite clear that many hadiths are full of metaphors. And this is what we're hearing today, that it's full of metaphors. We heard about Dajjal, the one-eye monster. We heard about breaking the cross and killing the swine. And there's many more about when the Messiah comes, the sun will rise from the west, and he will come on the wings of 2 angels. And there's so many more I could go on. My question is, can the panel explain to the audience, just to avoid any ambiguity or any confusion, why were they written metaphors? Why wasn't it clear that actually this is going to happen?
Okay, well, this again is very similar to the question that was posed here. So, Kasoof, could you explain this, please?
Well, obviously, as Mansoor Saab and Ayaz Saab have already explained, that the metaphors, they've been used for certain reasons. But I think the main reason, which Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, Mirza Ghulam of Qadian alayhi salatu wasalam, explained, was that if everything was said clear-cut, that, you know, in the Quran, Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Saab Qadiani is going to come, accept him, do bayt at his hand, he's going to have this many believers, 40 people who do bayt at his hands at first, Who will not accept him?
Yes.
I mean, what will be the difference between a mu'min and a kafir? Everyone will be mu'min then. There's no difference between a mu'min, iman. There will nothing as iman and kufr. The whole purpose of man on this earth is not just to worship God Almighty, but it's to understand what that God Almighty is. In the Holy Quran, many verses have been explained that your God is this, this, this. If it was described clear-cut that your God is this, many people wouldn't understand. Now, as far as the Hadith is concerned, many people may have understood, but many wouldn't have. Many would have gone, I don't think anyone would have gone astray though. Many people, everyone would have accepted the Hadith. So there wouldn't have been any difference between the mu'mineen and the disbelievers.
It's the equivalent of me saying that, well, do you believe that this table exists?
Yeah, exactly.
And you will all say, well, yes, the table is here. I'm saying this is a black table and it exists, it's in my hands. There's absolutely no room for you to believe that it doesn't exist. there'll be no point. Belief and religion is something which is leaves you that gap to say, this is Iman. You take that one more step that you can't see, that is belief in truth, right?
Even in the Bible, we see that regarding the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it says that he will be a prince. He will be a prince. He will be wonderful. It didn't say his name. It didn't say, signified a little bit towards his name. I think that's the closest it's got to describing the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it said he will be wonderful. It's described him in attributes. Now, regarding the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I'd just like to mention one more hadith, just for the benefit of our viewers as well, that there's another hadith in which the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that the Messiah will be buried in my grave. Now, if our non-Ahmadi brethren say that they want to be literalists, well then, look at this hadith. Any clear-minded Muslim will not accept that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's grave, na'uzubillah, God forbid, his grave be dug up and the Messiah be put in there with him. It can't be accepted as clear cut just like that. This is metaphorical language. Now the beauty in metaphorical language is used also in poetry. Why in poetry do we not say that I am very happy today and I'm? They describe it in long verses. They describe it. They don't say in one line that I'm very happy today. They say in lines of 20 to 30 verses. Why do they say that? Then our brother Muslims, they'll say, well, these people are crazy, because they describe it. They go on and on and on.
The beauty of it is
in the description of it. And God's language is sublime and it's beautiful. It's not clear cut that this person will come accept him, because then there will be no difference between a person who believes. Then everyone will believe. There's no test. That's what the Promised Messiah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. There will be no test in this world.
Brilliant. I saw another. Yes, please.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. As everyone can see in these days, that the whole world is in war of economics or socially. So is there any sign of Promised Messiah relating to the war or in these days?
Okay, so you're asking if there's, regarding the fact that nowadays we see that there's a whole unrest, a worldwide unrest. Countries are at war, countries are in social, economic, religious, there's all types of wars that are going on right now. So regarding the Promised Messiah, we've talked about there's different signs regarding the Promised Messiah. Is there anything regarding war? Qudusa, please.
Just quickly, in one of the hadiths is also mentioned, yada'ul harb, that he will stop the fighting. So this is another sign for the Messiah to come, that at the time that there'll be so much going on, there's so much disorder in the world, that the Holy Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam will stop that war and will build a community which will be spreading peace. And as you know, our motto, love for all, hatred for none. I think that will suffice.
Again, another point to remember is that in the Quran it says, Zahrul Fasadu fil Barri wal Bahr, that the facade, the turmoil as it were, will be so covering the world. This is the state in which a prophet will come. So the world will be so deep inside war, so deep in turmoil, frustration and anger, that this will make a perfect bed for which the Promised Messiah will come in, and he'll rejuvenate the faith, which was also goes back to the point that we talked about, Mujaddidin. This was Mujaddid's point. This was the 14th Mujaddid point. Okay, yes, please, Abdul Qudusab, if you'd like to say anything else.
With regards to this, again, you've mentioned that Zahar al-Fasad bil Barri wal Bahr. It refers to such a time, this is the time when God Almighty will say that a prophet is needed. So this disorder had to happen in the world. There had to be so much going on in the world which is against Islam, etc., that God Almighty, His Rahmah, His blessings will come to light and say that, hold on, that's it, these Muslims,
yes,
it's about time that I send my helper, I send my Messiah, I send my Imam Mahdi. So that's why it was needed for all this to happen in the world. For example, the wars, the disorder, there's so much disagreement between everyone. And that is why God Almighty sent His Messiah,
brilliant,
to sort all this disagreement out.
Okay, brilliant. Yes, please.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
I have a non-Ahmadi friend. He raises an allegation. He states the hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which mentions that the Mahdi, or the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, he will descend near a white minaret. So his allegation is the Minara-tul-Masih presently in Qadian was built after the demise of the Promised Messiah salatu wasalam. So how can it be proved as a fulfillment of the prophecy?
Okay, Yasa, please.
See, if we understand all of the prophecies collectively, yes, we will see, and this is the theme which we have been reiterating again and again and again, that these are similes, these are metaphors, these are not to be taken literally. Now, where will he descend beside? Will he descend beside the White Minaret at a certain level? If you speak to non-Ahmadis, many of them say that he will come, he will descend on to the White Minaret. This is non-Ahmadis. If you ask them where will he descend, they say that he will come with angels and descend at the head of that minaret, and then as if people would put a ladder up for him and then he would climb down that ladder. So this is what non-Ahmadis say. We don't say that. Now, as far as this concept is concerned of descending close to a White Minaret, it says in the Minara-tul-Baida, near a White Minaret, not upon that. Okay, not ala Minara-tul-Baida. So what this signifies, as we have mentioned again and again, metaphorically speaking, is that what is a minaret? A minaret is a symbol of announcement.
Yes.
It is a symbol of, if you were talking of a beacon, of something which shows light. A huge tower,
a lighthouse,
which gives guidance to people. This is the same case with this White Minaret, that the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, when he comes, his mission would be such that he would announce to the people, just as the Adhan is called out from the minarets of the mosque, so too he would call out the name of God, and he would call people towards God who had forgotten their God. And then, as far as the building of the minaret is concerned, the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam's desire, and prophets in general, their desire is that if something is metaphorical, it is obviously performed in their lives, that metaphorical fulfillment takes place.
Definitely.
But the prophets also desire that if it is possible, that a symbol should also be erected physically as well to represent that prophecy.
Definitely.
So that's why the promised Messiah alayhi salam built the Minara-tul-Masih after, as a symbol that the Messiah was to descend beside a white minaret. Why? To announce the name of Allah to the people who had forgotten him, and to give guidance to a world which was bereft of guidance. But after that, the promised Messiah said that the secondary meaning should also be fulfilled, as is in my power. That's why he built the White Minaret, as we see the Minara-tul-Masih in Qadian.
When he prophesied with Suraqah bin Malik, he goes, "Oh Suraqah, what will be your condition when the bangles of Persia, the Persian bangles will be given to you?" And this was fulfilled at the time of Hazrat Umar r.a. And what did he do? He physically fulfilled that prophecy, even though gold is not permitted for man to wear. So again, you see that this is the same with the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's prophecy.
So we have, again, the topic that we're talking about is that we cannot take something which is so beautiful. We have the example of the Holy Quran in front of us, which is so full to the brim of absolute beautiful poetry, metaphoric and simulaic language. So how is it that we, as the followers of the Holy Quran, can only take the literal meaning for absolutely everything that we see? Okay, please. Sorry, does that answer your question? Okay, brilliant. Yes, please.
Assalamu alaikum. One of the claims of the promised Messiah is that Jesus alayhi salam will not die or has not died on the cross. So basically my question is there scientific proof of that Jesus alayhi salam's grave is in India? That's what Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam claims. Is there any scientific proof of that?
Okay, so your question is that scientific and historical evidence,
exactly,
of the fact that Jesus is actually buried in Kashmir in India.
Right.
So
yeah.
Is there any scientific and historical proof that we can actually give to categorically prove that Jesus is actually in Srinagar in India, as it
were? Yeah, that's right.
Kasoof, could you shed some
many
light?
Researchers, I believe, have, even before the time of the promised Messiah, they did suggest it, but not as with a surety that the promised Messiah presented this research.
Another thing, that there is a biblical account which all people agree to, and the promised Messiah alayhi salam has also presented this as scientific evidence as well. He says that when the Messiah was put on the cross, he was put on the cross on Friday. And on Saturday, the Jews, they used to take off all of the criminals from the cross because they believed that was their Sabbath day, the holy day. So practically, Jesus alayhi salam only remained on the cross alayhi salatu wasalam for about 3 to 4 hours, which is not enough to kill a healthy man on the cross. It was a slow, gradual deterioration took place.
That's the whole point of the crucifixion.
Absolutely. And then another thing which is mentioned is that when he was taken off, his legs were not broken.
Yes.
Hazur Rabi rahimahullah ta'ala used to mention this so eloquently and beautifully in his question and answer sessions. He said his legs were not broken. Then when they pierced him, blood and water gushed forth.
Yes.
Scientifically speaking, medically speaking, doctors say that until your heart is pumping, blood and water cannot gush out. It oozes out slowly.
It comes out. Yeah.
So all of these things prove that he was saved from the cross. And this also suggests to the fact that he moved on. And he moved on to Kashmir. Because of the fact that the promised Messiah alayhi salam is mentioned, that since Jesus alayhi salam was taken off of the cross and the testimony of the Bible suggests that he was saved from the cross, this also furnishes proof to us that he went on to take a further journey. And we say that that journey was towards Kashmir, and the reason for that was because his mission would not have been complete if he did not go there. And we cannot accept that any prophet goes without completing his mission, because there were many tribes of the Bani Israel which the Jesus alayhi salam had not yet conveyed his message to.
Was in fact, according to the Bible and the Quran, specifically for those 12 tribes of Israel. And it's, you ask for historical proof, it's historically proven that over the course of the Jewish history, many of the tribes, in fact only two if I'm not mistaken, were still present in the area where Jesus was in fact crucified. The other 10 had spread. This is not something that was just the Ahmadiyya Jama'at proposes. This is something which is proven in Jewish history books, that the other 10 tribes had spread along the area of Afghanistan and over the area of India. Okay? Does this answer your question? So Kudus, do you have anything to add on this?
No, just the historical account is that at the time of Nebuchadnezzar,
yes,
I mean, he's the one who took the 10 tribes who were in the northern part of Jerusalem and basically shifted them into the eastern hemisphere side. And so we find that the Bible says that Christ says himself that I have not sent but unto the lost tribes of Israel. Those were the 10 lost tribes of Israel.
Yes.
So these people, if the Messiah had not gone unto them, then his work would have not been completed.
Definitely.
And how can a prophet who's sent by God Almighty, his work not be completed? Because he has God Almighty's hand behind him, and that is his main purpose, is to fulfill his task, which he did, alhamdulillah. Okay.
We've seen today that, alhamdulillah, we've had many questions from the audience, and we've had more than satisfactory answers from our panelists. So if there's anyone outside of the studio that would like to come in and partake in this program, to pose their questions and to ask our panel members face to face, as it were, then please feel free to contact your regional guide and ask for details and ask if you can actually participate with us so that we can actually interact better with each other. For those others that are at home and wish to send in your questions and queries or comments, you can contact us on our voicemail, which is 0044-2086-878032. You can text in your questions to 0044-777-5593-719. If you'd like to view our previous programs to see the questions which were posed before, maybe your answers could be in there. Or possibly if you just want to experience the feel of Beacon of Truth in the past few programs, you can visit us on YouTube and view those previous programs on MTA Online 1. Similarly, you can contact us via your email on beacon@mta.tv. It's beacon@mta.tv. And we encourage you again and again to please contact us and send in those comments and queries, because we want to take those questions and discuss them, because we wish to move forward together. We've reached the end of the program. I'd like to say thank you and jazakallah to my studio audience, my esteemed panel of guests, and most of all, my dearest viewers at home. Inshallah, we'll meet again in the next program. Until then, fi amanillah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Allahumma labbaik labbaik.